For the next 45 minutes, we're going to kind of do a cruise through the world of seismic geomorphology. And I'll show you workflows, I'll show you patterns, and we'll have some fun with it. And I'm using the Paradigm Suite. And again, I'm doing this because it's fun. And I'm not paid to do this, so but I can tell you that for my money, if my money were involved, this would be the software I would be using. Just saying, as they say. So the theme of the next 45 minutes is mining 3D seismic data for stratigraphically significant features, workflows, and applications. So the obvious question is, why do we do this? And it's a no-brainer. I'm preaching to the choir. You know why we do this. We do this to reduce uncertainty, especially with respect to predicting lithology before we drill. But then there are also ancillary benefits. For example, if you recognize a particular feature in the subsurface, say a channel or whatever, that's what I would use then to evaluate seismic processing. So we can use it to assist geophysical processing. I have a known feature, a channel. I can see whether it got better or it got worse. But most importantly, and this is kind of a soapbox that I get on, most importantly, you should be looking at the map view. Because when we look at section views, we're not as good at recognizing the patterns that are important. You may think you have a channel, but until you see it in map view, the proof is in the mapping. And so when you're evaluating a geophysical product that someone is saying, oh, I've really made the data better, I've done this, I've done that, the acid test is to look in map view and look at the seismic geomorphology and see if, in fact, it got better. So assisting seismic processing is another business justification. Also, of course, we spend tremendous amounts of money on seismic data. Why not leverage that data to the maximum? Squeeze out of it, mine as much as you can out of it. And in order to do that, you've got to fulfill two requirements. One is you have to have good workflows, and the other is once you have the patterns, you have to be able to think geologically to populate those patterns appropriately. Seeing a channel is one thing. Knowing where to put the sand relative to that channel or carbonate buildup or whatever it is you're looking at is another. So it's all about pattern recognition, but more importantly, what do you do with it? So let me go back a second. What you're seeing in the background is a levee channel. It's a channel in the Gulf of Mexico. It's Pleistocene in age. And you can see the blues represent slightly deeper, the hot colors slightly shallower. So what you're looking at is what we would call in the world of fluvial deposits, you call that an alluvial ridge. Here you might call it a channel ridge, but it illustrates how the channels build up from the basin floor by courtesy of the levees that keep the flows in place. If you look more carefully, you'll see the levees on both sides of this channel. And you can see it here, you can see the levee here. This mouse is a little bit slow, so bear with me. You can also see these lineaments on the side. Those are sediment waves. The challenge, of course, is where do you put sand, where do you put silt, where do you put mud? The channel itself is characterized by a convex up pattern. Bumps are good. Bumps are telling us differential compaction has occurred, where the stuff on the side has collapsed, the channel, because it's sand-filled, is elevated. And the interesting thing is how quickly that occurs after deposition. So you look at a section view, and the differential compaction probably occurs within maybe 10 or 15,000 years, and it's already a bump. So there are a lot of learnings, ancillary learnings, from looking at seismic data in this way. So the next image is a fluvial system. Again, channels. And there are a lot of interesting features here. This is from the Gulf of Thailand, and it's in the Pleistocene section, so it's near seafloor. As you go deeper, of course, the quality of the data diminishes, but we can use the shallow section to learn about geology, to develop analogs. So in this particular instance, we're looking at a single-threaded river system, meandering system, where the channel is populated by this kind of bland gray color. And when you see it in cross-section, it sags. So as bumps indicate sand, sagging reflections indicate mud. So this is a mud-filled channel. But we have sand in these dark areas. Those are the point bars. So in fluvial systems, the point bars are where you look for the sand. The channel, the last position of the channel is what you're looking at here. That's mud. And so potentially, you're looking at reservoir compartmentalization associated with sand here and mud there. So there are other features in here too, these kind of stringy little things here. We see this on the lower reaches of rivers. You see it if you ever have a chance to go to Google Earth, the Gulf of Carpentaria, northern Australia. There's a bunch of channels feeding up into the Gulf, and they all have the same pattern with these kind of stringy features here. Those are tidal channels. They're produced by the twice a day up and down of the water. So these fluvial channels are not strictly fluvial anymore. We've captured a bit of marine influence. So if I had a core through here, what I would anticipate would be at least playing itself out if you look at the trace fossils, you'd be looking at marine influence, at least of the upper part of that point bar. And it's all about pattern recognition. So the workflows, there's a laundry list of workflows that we can apply to mining the data. In this particular image, you're looking at simply an illuminated surface. No amplitude, nothing. All it is pick the surface, shine a light on it, and depending on which direction you shine it from, you see different things. But in this particular example, we're looking at a couple of fluvial systems. And more specifically, you can see a point bar with the swing of the point bar expanding through time. And we would put that's a sand-rich setting here. Now we can take this a step further. Now look at this fluvial system here. You can kind of you can kind of see the last position of the channel. And that's this more prominent thread. And when you look at the channel, you can measure its width. This particular channel is about 200 meters wide. And because these channels are behaving in a predictive way, we can also look at the depth of the channel, which is roughly equivalent to the depth the thickness of the point bar. And the thickness of the point bar scales to the amplitude of this meandering pattern. So just based on the pattern alone, we can predict the thickness, or we can make a stab at predicting the thickness. So actually, before I go on, so some of the workflows we'll talk about, the obvious ones, you know, you look at inlines, you look at cross lines, you look at depth or time, and then we'll talk about optical stacks, datuming, creative datuming. I'll kind of walk you through that. Then sculpting, channel chasing, horizon attributes, interval, all of these things, all of these workflows are designed to extract patterns from the seismic data. And then it's up to you to interpret those patterns. It's up to you to populate those patterns correctly. And that's where you take off your geophysical hat and you put on your geological hat. So what's the key to success? Well, number one, you got to know how to mine your data to find significant patterns. So with respect to how do you decide what's a significant pattern? Well, that's where the guys with gray hair have an advantage because they've seen more stuff. The more you see, the more you can recognize what's significant and what's not. You don't want to be, if you're looking for depositional elements, you don't want to be confusing depositional elements with potentially structural features or fluid features. You want to know what's depositional. You also want to know what's noise. So you gotta know a bit about geophysics too. So you gotta know how to mine your data. You need good software that's fast, that allows you to test ideas quickly. As soon as you put speed bumps in the way by having slow software or software that doesn't do exactly what you want, you're not being efficient. And as many of us know, we're often given a 3D volume and we're told, I need an answer yesterday. So, you know, they spend gobs of money acquiring the data, months and months and months and months. They finally give it to the interpreter and he's got 2 weeks to interpret it. So you got to be fast, you got to be efficient, and you've got to be you've got to have the experience to know what's important and what's not. So that's where step two comes in. So once you've mined the data, then you've got to populate the patterns appropriately. So what are the key takeaways with respect to workflows? Really, one of the fundamental ones is to integrate what you see in section view with what you see in plan view. It's the integration of seismic stratigraphy with seismic geomorphology. So stratigraphy is the study of the layering of the rocks. You see that in the section views. Geomorphology is the study of landforms. You see that in the map view. You got to keep iterating back and forth. If you have an idea of an interpretation based on a section view, you have to corroborate it. You have to test it with the plan view, and vice versa. If I see something meandering, I'm going to want to take the perfect section through there to make sure it's indeed a channel. Or, you know, you can create these patterns just by slicing poorly. So integrate the seismic stratigraphy with the seismic geomorphology. Pattern recognition is critical. Efficient and creative workflows, and then all of this is done with the backdrop of context. The more you can narrow down your range of interpretive options, the better your outcome will be. So knowing, for example, that I'm in a shallow water setting or a deep water setting, a clastic setting, a carbonate setting, and so forth and so on, the more you can narrow down the context, the better an answer you get, because there are some features, you know, some patterns that show up in multiple different settings, and you would populate them very differently depending on where you've encountered them. So what are the caveats? Well, we often are asked, well, can you find me some reservoir? Well, reservoir presence is one thing, reservoir quality is another. And we're way better at predicting reservoir presence than reservoir quality. Reservoir quality requires you to know geohistory, it requires you to know mineralogy, it requires a lot of stuff, heat flow. So reservoir quality is more difficult to pin down. So we're kind of happy to be able to predict reservoir presence. Reservoir quality is the next step. As you, and bullet number two, data quality diminishes with depth. The deeper you get, the lower the resolution, the lower the detectability. Data quality is impacted by the presence above the target section of bad stuff like volcanics or carbonates are not bad stuff, but high velocity stuff up shallow. So your signal deteriorates with depth, and so the quality of the images you're going to get obviously are not going to be great as you get deeper. So it's not a perfect world. And as I said before, some stratigraphic patterns provide non-unique solutions. And then there are multiples and fluid contacts and all of the stuff that gets in our way. In the background, you're looking at a surface that's the base Cretaceous unconformity in the Alberta Basin in Canada. And when you look at section view, you know you've got a key surface. You know it's a surface that has significance. It cuts reflections. It's a high amplitude reflection. But to see it in three dimensions, it really comes alive. You know, you can see this through-going channel right here, and then you've actually got a drainage network here draining a highland area over there. So you can start waxing poetic and say, well, at the time that this was exposed, the water table was a good deal lower here than it was down in this valley. So you start thinking about the impact of groundwater and karsting and things like that, because this is all a carbonate subcrop. So you can look at these maps and start to make a geologic story out of them. We see patterns in multiple domains. We see patterns in the section view. We see patterns in the map view. We see patterns when we look in perspective. We see patterns when we animate, and I'll show you that. That's probably one of the lesser utilized pattern styles or domains. And then there are patterns in geologic or sequence stratigraphic view where we look at successions and we say, well, I see this here. I expect that to be in a cycle of sedimentation. I would expect a different style to follow . So there are patterns in the time domain, in the geologic time domain. But let me show you, for example, let me stop here and let's look at the animated view for a moment. What I did was in Voxel Geo, I created an animated movie and playing it with QuickTime. So let me play it through once quickly, then let me back up and show you some features, and then we'll look at it slightly differently. This is an excellent way to evaluate the subsurface very quickly. So let's start the movie, and it goes quickly through here. And, well, rather than bore you, let me go back and stop it. All of these little pieces here, these guys here, that there, those are all channels. These are fluvial channels, this is a fluvial system. But it's not compelling. Now, it doesn't really, it's not, you can't really, pound the table and convince everyone these are big fluvial systems. So what I've then done is look at what's called an optical stack. Okay, so what's involved here is I'm looking at a slab of 30 slices, making them partially transparent, so only the positive amplitudes are opaque, looking at it from above, and so if the channels show up in that positive domain, I'll see the whole channel. But watch the difference. So we're slicing through, and you can see the channels. Let me go back. And so they're much more complete. You can see them very nicely. And this was without flattening the volume. And there are lots of faults through here. But without even flattening, because there's not that much offset, the channel may jump from one fault block to another, but they still remain within the same slab. So you see them very clearly. So, and this notion of animation, I can go back and forth and have a sense of the paleogeography in a way that a static image doesn't let you. I always like to show, let me show you another example of a, okay, so this is a picture out of my back window in Canmore. Those of you who have been to Banff have probably driven through Canmore. But what I want to show you this to make the point that animation reveals patterns that static images do not. So you can see these mountains and the clouds. Well, the mountains don't move, so they'll stay in the same place. But the clouds are moving. Do you know which way the clouds are moving? Yeah, you might guess, based on this guy kind of tilting that way. But once I animate, what you'll see is that some of the clouds are moving one way and some are moving another. It's patterns that you're getting from the animated domain that you never really appreciated in the static domain. So as I animate this, you can see the upper clouds are going towards the left, the lower clouds are going towards the right. The static image never would have allowed you to make that, draw that conclusion. And we do the same with seismic. We can quickly, let's stop that. We can quickly see patterns. It's an excellent first reconnaissance step. Let me show you another data set. Okay, so this is a slope and basin floor setting. I didn't flatten, the slope is pretty steep. And so what I'm gonna do is very quickly animate through here with an optical stack. So it's looking here, there, 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 there. So I'm scrolling through the data. So let's go through here. I'll go through here once quickly. You can see the sea floor reveal itself. You can see various depositional elements. Let me come back. Let me drag it this way. So initially we see all of these linear features coming off of the top. Those are mostly debris flow deposits. All that speckling that you see, the spots in here, those are clasts, large clasts. You know, these are the size of houses and bigger that are coming down the slope. So the slope is coming down here. So as I continue to go here, so we haven't really seen anything sinuous that would suggest turbulent flow and turbidites until we get to around here. And then you can see right in here, and this is without flattening. This is an optical stack that we're just quick reconnaissance. So already I've high graded where I'm going to start my search, and that's right in here. As I keep going, the story changes a bit. Now I'm seeing some channels right in here. And by going back and forth, quickly back and forth, I get a good sense, even though at any one moment I'm not seeing the whole landscape or seascape, by going back and forth, I get a pretty good picture of the way the depositional systems were arranged. Okay, so back to the PowerPoint. And let's go back to presentation. So we've looked at map view. We'll look at section view. We'll go live with some data in a moment. And here you can see in this particular image, there are patterns. So what do we see here? Well, we see these lineaments right in here. These lineaments right over, let's see, there we go. Where's my mouse? There it is. Yeah, let me actually turn it on permanently. Pointer options and visible. Okay, so you can see these lineaments here. These are sediment waves. They're about a kilometer in wavelength and a relief of maybe 15 meters. Very low relief, but when you squeeze the section, they become pretty dramatic. And they are a landform that's very common in the deep water. And we also see, if you look closely, you can see what looks like a cliff, a sharp drop-off right here. And you can see another cliff over here. Moving to the right, we can see some more grooves, or some more, actually, we see some grooves and what look like waveforms in here, but multiple grooves here. These are indications, these are grooves associated with the passage of debris flows. So the slope, the paleo slope, was downhill this way. So what happened here, you're looking at a lot more, we looked at a lot more data than you're looking at now, but to fast forward, there were massive debris flows that came down the slope, and they actually passed over this area and pulled out, literally plucked out the substrate. So these grooves, actually, these grooves that you see here continue on the other side. So what the seismic is teaching us is something about process that we hadn't really appreciated or known about until we had images like this. So we learn about process, we learn about lithologic distribution. So there's a lot, so much to be gained, so much to be learned from seismic data. And again, I'm preaching to the choir, so I'll move on. So here's an example of a single channel complex. This is rivers. This is a fluvial system. And what I've done here is picked just the channel fill. And the background is meant to indicate structure. The channel fill itself, that's amplitude, which we'll use as a proxy for lithology. So looking at this in detail, we're going to focus on those two areas. There's a suggestion that the meander loop, if we can determine the direction of meander loop migration, we can make a prediction as to which way that river was flowing. So blowing it up a bit, we can see that there's crossover over here of an amplitude field, and again crossover over here. And we can see this kind of V-shaped notch over here, and another V-shaped notch over here. The way we would interpret this, and we also see, by the way, that the channel belt is going from wide to narrow to wide. That's the hallmark of a single-threaded system, a single-threaded river system, or a meandering channel. So we can populate that, or infer that the paleo flow was from upper right to lower left with over a succession of time periods, and the last position of the channel is shown in the solid color. So just based on the pattern that we see of the amplitude pattern, the changing widths of the channel belt, we can predict the paleo current direction, we can infer its origin. This is fluvial. We can even predict the thickness based on the wavelength of this meander loop. So there's a lot to be gained that may you may not have appreciated. This pattern is a pattern that I ran across and you know is really cool. And as they say, the caption I put in here, when things are not necessarily as they appear. Well, it's a really interesting pattern. There's actually a few things to note. First, notice these lineaments running this way. And then, of course, as they say, the elephant in the room is that pattern. So when I first looked at it, I wasn't sure, is it distributive, meaning is it spreading out like a delta? Or is it tributive, like a drainage system? On the face of it, it's very hard to make that call. So you dive deeper, you look at it in more detail. So first thing we looked at, let's look at reflection amplitude of a horizon slice. And all right, you can see what looks like a very dendritic pattern. But again, can you differentiate between tributive coming to a point? In other words, was the paleo current going this way, or was it coming the other way, which would make these all little lobes? There's a big difference between the two. So we see both patterns in nature, in the modern. So this is a distributive pattern in the Gulf of Mexico. This is a fan lobe. So that was one option. And then we can go onshore to Wyoming, and we can see a tributive pattern, very similar in its map pattern, very different with respect to how you would populate them. So let's have a closer look at this. Again, tributive or distributive. In this instance, I've actually picked the horizon and illuminated it. And the light source is on the upper right. So the light is shining actually almost from the right side. These are actually faults right in here, small faults right in here. So the light is shining from the right towards the left. And you're starting to get a sense that we can make a judgment call. And it looks like this is tributive, not distributive. So this is a drainage system, not a fan. But hold on. So slicing and shifting up and down, we can see those lineaments really very well developed in the background. And that's part of the story. So now let's look at it in perspective view. And now we can see very clearly it's a drainage network. And so you would populate this image very differently from how you would populate it if it was distributive. So we can take that surface, we can illuminate it, which means just put a light source on it, and you can see the drainage network very nicely. This is a fault over here, that's a fault over here, so you got to kind of look through that. So just for analogs, this is a very small scale analog. Those are seashells over here. And we're going to look at this guy right there. And that's essentially what we're looking at in very small scale. So it's an analog to what we have right here. It's the same pattern, totally different scale. So to compare it to something at a similar scale, we go back to Wyoming, and you can see this drainage network very clearly right here, and that's essentially what we have there. So taking a step further, remember I said it's essential to always go from the map view to the section view, back again, that iterative process. Now let's look at stratigraphy on the side here. So now we've got a seismic section that's just outboard of this drainage network. So we look at it, and what we can see is pretty clear evidence for progradation coming across here. Relatively steep angle. That shouldn't read 9. This is anywhere from 2 to 5 degrees. But upwards of 5 degrees, 6 degrees in here where it's really steep. When we look at these inclined reflections, they don't flatten out. They literally come straight down. And if you think back to your Geology 101, think Gilbert deltas where avalanching is the dominant process and you don't have much runout. That's probably what we've got here. Very steep, relatively steep angles, probably, and again, we don't know for sure, probably quite sand prone. And when we look at this in section view, so this line of section is right here. And we can see the excavation. So all of this material has been removed. And if you look at this strike section right here, whoops, that strike section right there, you can see all of the drainage divides and all the downcutting. And in the background, you can see the shingles, the cliniforms, the prograde, moving off in both directions, because this is roughly a strike view. We can also see where the material that was excavated from here ends up. It ends up out there. And here we can just see it in map view. We can see this high amplitude field out here. That's out there. The dark area is the material that was excavated from this area here. Okay, let me show you one more workflow. And if we have time then, if not, we'll blow it off. If we have time, we'll look at some data live. And what you're seeing here is a section through this is the Vaca Muerta. And you can see these nice prograde coming across. If you look at it really carefully, you would probably see small little patch reefs sitting up here in the shallow water part. But we're going to focus down here at the base of these prograde. So we know that above the prograde, well, it's relatively deep water. Whatever this relief comes to, a couple 300, 400 meters, something like that. So this would represent right down here relatively deep water. And right below here we've got a horizon that we know from the literature is shallow water to non-marine. At least that's what the conventional wisdom tells us. So what we want to do, first of all, is restore this seismic section to its pre-structural to a pre-structural view, meaning we want to flatten on something to make these prograde look like they're just kind of coming right across. So we've got a choice. We've got to choose a horizon upon which to flatten. And you know, you could choose a horizon above, you could choose a horizon below. I chose the one below because it was easier to pick. So when we choose a horizon upon which to flatten, we're making some assumptions. We're assuming, number one, that the horizon was flat at the time of deposition and it was horizontal. And if those two assumptions are true, we've restored the section reasonably well. As it turns out, that's rarely the case. Its surfaces are rarely that featureless. And this is one of those examples. So that's the surface we picked, and you'll see the result of that. So what I've done is two things. I picked the surface itself. You can see the pick right there. And then you can see a smoothed version of that. So I smoothed the heck out of it. I really smoothed it to eliminate all the wiggles. So now let's see what the result is. So first, when I flatten on the actual picked horizon, you can see it's nice and smooth. But what I've done by flattening on a bumpy surface is I've created all kinds of bumps above. So I've created artifacts all up and down the section that are not real because that surface was not flat at the time of deposition. So instead, I flatten on the smooth picked horizon, and everything above remains relatively smooth like it did in the original. So looking at it more closely, you can see the artifacts that I've created by flattening just on a picked surface. So here we can see the result, you know, focusing on this part of the section, of flattening on the smooth picked horizon, and it gives a better result. So it's best to flatten on the smooth pick than on the original picked horizon. So what does it look like? What does the original horizon look like in the flattened domain? Well, this is what it looks like. And you first look at it, and I'm sure that half of you see ridges and half of you see valleys or little troughs. Well, the answer is that it's probably both. But what I do now, because it's in the flattened domain, I very carefully adjust the color range so that the low areas will be one color, the high areas will be another, and it really comes alive. This is an aeolian landscape. These are wind-blown dunes. And that's consistent with what the conventional wisdom has for that level. So these are aeolian dunes. The relief is about 12 meters milliseconds. At this depth, probably about 15 meters, 20 meters. The wavelength is about 1.5 kilometers. And the interpretation then, and it's a pattern to store away in case you see it again, the interpretation here, given the context, is that these are aeolian dunes formed subaerially just prior to the drowning event. And it also tells you that when the sea washed in, it didn't do that with a lot of energy because it would have probably eroded all of those ridges. So we can infer, number one, that the transgression, when it occurred, was not accompanied by high wave energy. And second of all, if it was not accompanied by high wave energy, it speaks to what we can expect on the associated shorelines. We would expect those not to be wave-dominated shorelines. They would be either tide or fluvial-dominated. So even just seeing the preservation of these guys suggests, you know, they're always, you never say never, but it suggests that this was a wave poor climate because the erosive capabilities of the transgressive event were not high. Or, you know, but there, as I say, never say never. It's possible maybe these were cemented up prior to transgression. And so, you know, you can't be sure. All you know is those Aeolian dunes were preserved. So lastly, you know, the key takeaway to get the best image, choose wisely the best surface upon which to flatten. And again, always alternate between the plan view and the section view. So finally, comparing, you always like to find modern analogs, and Namibia provides a really good modern analog for what we see in the subsurface. Very similar scale features, and obviously we know this is a sand desert. And that is probably what characterized this location in Paleo Argentina. So with that, let me wrap it up and say thank you for coming. And good luck mining your data. There's a lot more in the seismic data than you probably ever thought. But again, don't overinterpret. I see too often people taking it too far and undermining their own credibility. Be clear on what you see and how you interpret. Be clear what's observation, what's interpretation. And you'll add a lot of value to your seismic data and your exploration effort. Thank you.